Peace Party people, this is Let the Record Show. I am Mike Pizzo.
I'm Warren Peace.
And today's special guests are...
It's Rapper Big Pooh.
Phonte. We are little brother.
Yes, indeed.
Thank you for being here, guys. It's kind of cool because Phonte, like, you came with Nicolay on our episode 2.
Yeah.
Very early. And, like, now we're, like, 40 episodes deep.
Yep.
So, I was an early adopter.
Yeah, so thank you. And Hip Hop Slay, we were early adopters of Little Brother as well, so it's cool. It's all coming full circle. I love
it. It's full circle, yeah, totally.
Yeah, yeah. So you guys got your new album right here.
Yes.
May the Lord Watch. This is one of the best albums of 2019.
Yeah.
Thank you, man.
Thank you so much, man.
We appreciate
thank
it.
You.
Yeah. Great album. It's on vinyl now, so this is great. You can actually physically hold it in your hand.
Yeah.
So yeah, this is one of the first episodes of our socially distant series of Let the Record Show. I think record heads are naturally socially distant. We like to just be in our hole anyway. So this isn't really so different for us. But we stalked your tweets. We stalked your Instagram to kind of see what, like, you guys, what some of your favorite albums of all time are and records of all time are. So we tracked those down. And now we're going to play those and let the record show.
Yes, indeed.
Yeah, all right. Let's do it. All right, first up, we have De La Soul is Dead, and Phonte, this is on your Instagram 10 album challenge late last year, I guess.
Yeah.
So we talked about Ring, Ring, Ring. You said you were going to pull Ring, 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 but then you said, let's do Johnny's Dead.
There we go.
Yeah, how's that volume there?
I can hear it. Perfect, it sounds good.
Perfect. It sounds good, yeah.
Yeah. So, tell us about your experience with this album. I know Little Brother is heavily influenced by Native Tongue, as we've talked about before.
Man, this song, this skit, like, yo, this is everything that, you know, I kind of wanted to be.
Yeah.
First, just the horrible piano playing, like, just the terrible piano playing. And De La Soul is Dead was just one of them records that, I mean, when I first heard Ring, 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 it felt so good.
Yeah.
And then I got the album and it was coming off 3 feet High. So I knew kind of what to expect. I mean, I knew kind of what the De La thing was. But De La Soul is Dead just took that to a whole nother level. And
you got to put it on your forehead, boy.
What?
It's dead.
How about you?
The concrete. The last word when he got shot.
Here's the greatest line in the whole shit. Here's the greatest line coming up right here. This is the greatest line right here.
What about his mama?
What about his mama? Josephine? What about his fucking Josephine? Come on, man. Are you serious?
This wasn't big for me. This wasn't big for me.
Yeah.
Wasn't big for me at all.
Okay. I mean, were you
not? Pooh, it was not.
Nah, I mean, wasn't big in my listening arsenal.
Okay,
gotcha.
Nah, man, that was just just hearing that record. It's funny listening to music now, just as a person that's actually been, in the game, for coming up, damn near 20 years now, But there's still moments I just hear now and I listen to records differently, as I once heard them as a consumer. And now I hear them, as a creator. And, like when I listen to old James Brown records and it's just like, yo, like, how the fuck did he get away with this shit? Like, they really just let him go in the studio and pretty much just record essentially jam sessions with his band. And that would be the single, And De La was just kind of that same thing to me. Listen to those records now, just that kind of creativity and just that, just kind of unrestricted, foolishness. I mean, that's just something that I don't really think we'll ever get to see again in that way, And just for something like Johnny's Dead, I mean, for that just essentially just be a skit that was rolling and they just kept it on the album, like for that to actually to use that, because we all do those kind of silly songs and skits or whatever, but they had the guts to actually use it, you know what I mean? And you know, just that kind of creativity and just that kind of that free spirit, you know, that's just something that you don't really see a lot anymore. So listening to those records is really is it just reminds me of a time when those things were not just allowed, but they were encouraged, you know?
Yeah, right.
Yeah, all right, there it is. De La Soul is dead. All right, next up, Pooh, on your list, or what we found in your tweets, Outcast, AT Aliens, we got the picture just here.
Yes.
This is so fly.
And you said, fitting right, enhance your brain.
Yeah, so tell us about, you know, the Outcast ATLN's LP, Wheels of Steel in particular.
This is my favorite Outcast album. It's just something about this album where they, you can feel that they really, really took the heart what happened at the Source Awards in 94. They went back to the drawing board and really, really came out with, you know, it's Southern, you know, it's Southern, but they showed you that they were really lyricists with this album. And I think for me, like, that's why this album really speaks to me. It's like you can hear the chip on their shoulder throughout the whole album. Right. And just how they worked off of each other as well. You can hear the chemistry was getting better. You know, just like Tay and I, our chemistry got better with each album.
Sure.
Their chemistry, you can hear their chemistry just taking that step up from all the hours that they put in together and all the time. And this is one of my favorite records, man. I'm not gonna lie, you could have dropped the needle on any song,
right,
to be honest with you, and it would have ran the same for me, man. I love Outkast, period, but this album just speaks to me differently than all the rest of the albums.
Yeah, go ahead, Phonte. What were you
saying? Oh man, I was gonna get a little controversial, if I may.
Okay, let's hear it.
Are we ready to admit? Are we finally ready to admit after all these years that Soul Food was better than ATL?
Oh, come on now.
No.
No, I don't know.
I mean, look.
Nah.
Look. Listen. Back. Okay, listen. This is straight up. So AT Aliens, be real, it was a grower for me. Like, you know what I'm saying? Like, I mean, when I first heard Elevators, I was like, okay, this is amazing. But I gotta be real. I mean, AT Aliens, I didn't get it at first. I was like, okay, I see it, but you know, I mean, the records were the records. To me, ATLNs didn't really hit until side two. And so, like, particularly like with Mainstream, like we were talking earlier, like that was the one I was like, holy shit, like this is what it is. But it wasn't until I watched the Goody Mob Unsung the other night. It came on TV One, and I kind of had a realization. I was like, man, that's why I think ATLNs didn't hit me when it first came out the way it did everyone else, because Goody Mob had kind of got to that part. They had got there first to me, you know what I mean? Like the things that I were looking for in the second Outkast album to be, Goody Mob did that with Soul Food, you know what I mean? And I mean, Soul Food, I played that record top to fucking bottom, front to back. Like that shit was an experience. So when I got to ATLNs, I was like, okay, I like this, but you know what I mean? So, and particularly with Wheels of Steel, with that record, that was one that I wasn't big on. Right. It wasn't until I saw them live. They came and they performed in Greensboro at the Greensboro Coliseum. It was like for Auntie's homecoming. It was Outkast, Busta Rhymes, Fugees, and Tribe. Mm-hmm. It was in 96. And so Cass did Wheels of Steel, and for the last verse, they rhymed over Set It Off by Strafe.
Mm. Nice.
And that was when I got it. I was like, ah, okay, this is, you know, that's when it made sense to me.
Yeah.
But that record, when I first heard it, I was like, okay, this is cool. But seeing it live and then living with the album, of course, I mean, you know, it's a classic. I learned to love it. But Soul Food was...
I can see the disgust on Pooh's face that likes to hear his...
I think, I'm not going to lie, I was just sitting here thinking about it. I think it may have been a regional thing.
Very much. So.
I didn't grow up in North Carolina. I grew up in Northern Virginia, and I think for people outside of the South, that even though for those in the South, Goody Mob, basically, with Soul Food. They took care of what I found in AT Aliens. Mm-hmm. Soul Food from Goody Mob didn't hit the same for me. Like, I liked the album, but it didn't speak the same to me. And I coming down south, I think that's, as I think about it more, I think that's really the thing. It's like, for those outside of the south, outside of this region, AT Aliens probably hit harder, because my artist Luke, that I manage, you can't tell him Soul Food by Goody Mob ain't like the best album ever out of the Dungeon right. family. You can't tell him that.
You know one of the things that was really interesting is that I felt like at this era, there was always people trying to make a crossover record, right? Or just have like one record, like every album at that point had the one song with R&B vocals, and it was right. always terrible. Always it was the worst
try
song
to,
the album.
Like, try to do me, right. Brand
yeah.
new me.
Yeah. Right. Yeah. Oh, yeah. Like, Helter yeah, yeah, Skelter yeah, yeah. Therapy. Like,
yeah. I mean,
like,
yeah.
Diamond D, Can't Keep My Grants to Myself.
Can't Keep My Grants to Myself?
like, I mean,
yo,
every album.
Out of diamond, yo, piece of diamond. Yo, like, nah, that
yeah,
wasn't,
of
mean,
course.
That wasn't,
but that wasn't, yeah. right, right. I mean, so every album has that one R&B song in that era. I felt like Outkast and Goody Mob, they were able to, like, seamlessly interpolate R&B vocals and soulful vocals, and it sounded so natural and clean.
And it wasn't pandering.
Right.
Right, was, right.
Yeah,
right.
yeah. Perfect.
I think a lot of that also was just the Dungeon Family organized noise. I mean, the funk they had brought in with their production to me was,
true.
Like, so
yeah.
different sounding and very soulful that I think yes. the two just blended. You know.
Yeah, and to me, like, the kind of the tragedy, if you even want to call it that, of organized noise, the thing with organized noise to me that was kind of sad was that to me the pinnacle of their production kind of happened after I guess the kind of wave had passed, because mm-hmm. to me their two best like production efforts were the Witch Doctor, a SWAT Healing Ritual album,
ooh.
And the Cool Breeze, East Point's Greatest Hits. Like,
ooh.
Them cool niggas showed they ass on that album. Like, them two records, production, what, man, that shit was incredible.
What was that Cool Breeze single? Da-na-na. That was.
Oh, Watch for the Hook.
Watch
for the Hook.
Oh, God.
Just Watch for the Hook.
That was when they organized noise had signed a deal with Interscope, right?
It was
the
Interscope deal.
Yeah.
But yeah, those two records, they were showing the fuck out on those joints, man. But it was kind of, you know, they kind of got caught in the label crossfire or whatever. But big ups to Organized Noise, man. Them cats is production gods.
Yeah, and if you haven't watched the documentary, definitely watch the Organized Noise documentary. So,
oh,
right,
yeah,
there it is.
Sure.
Outkast, AT Aliens. It's the 788. All right, so this is a bootleg of the first Slum Village T3 wrote on the...
wow.
Which is hilarious. So, like, this is crazy because this says... if you remember, they were on Interscope, like, really briefly.
Real quick,
this has, like, Interscope labels, and it looks very real. I mean, like, I was fooled by this, and I bought it thinking it was, like, a leak or something. Anyway, you can tell it's a bootleg because it's got New York on the back, not Detroit. So, yes, this is a bootleg, and when I brought this to T3, I was like, you know, back then, I was like, hey, bro, can you sign this? He's like, yeah, this is a bootleg of the first Slum Village, so. Yeah, so.
Wow.
Yeah, welcome to New York City.
So, Phonte, you got your cut here, which is Players.
Yeah,
and,
man.
I think A-Track picked this when we had him on the show, maybe.
Oh, wow.
I can't remember.
Okay.
Yeah. Okay. So, anyway. Yeah, tell us about Slum Village Fantastic Volume 2.
Man, I think Slum Village Fantastic Volume 2 was probably the last hip-hop album that scared me.
Mm.
Like, that was the last record I can think of, you know, that I heard, you know, because this is around the time when we were making, or what will become The Listening, you know what I'm saying? And that was the record I heard, and I was like, yo, if we ain't bringing it, like these niggas is bringing it, then we might as well just pack all this shit up, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
And you know, that was a record that totally changed the way that, you know, totally changed the way I listened to music. It changed my perception of what I thought a hip-hop record could sound like, and particularly with Players, it was just another one of those moments. I just heard it and I was just like, damn, like hip hop should not be this fucking good.
Right.
I'm like, this is really fucking good.
Yeah. Okay. Do you guys ever, you know, going down your career and looking at all the groups that you're fans of and everything, do you ever compare yourself to these guys as far as to Slum Village is how you, you know, go back and forth, your cadence, your production, like listening to your albums? I'm like, these guys, like, very, very close, like, as far as delivery, cadence, like, feel. Do you ever see that or?
I think we took a little bit from.
I'm not saying you copied. I'm just saying.
No, not at all. I think we took a little bit from all of our favorite groups.
Right. Okay.
We were students. We were definitely.
Yeah. Definitely students. So when you're a student, naturally you definitely look and see how you stack up against, you know, your favorites.
Right.
You know, Phonte said something like we talked about it the other day. Actually, at the time when we were making our record, and it was like we weren't competing against other people in our city or our state. We were competing against the people we grew up listening to.
Good point.
Right.
Yeah.
And
so that was always our thing. So when you do that, you're definitely comparing yourself to those groups to see how you stack up, whether it be a Slum Village or a De La Soul or Tribe or Outkast or UGK or whoever. Like, you always comparing to see where you stack up and you know, are you pushing yourself and doing everything you can to really compete at that level?
Right.
Good point.
Yeah. All right.
Yeah, that's kind of a. Oh, we can.
No, please go.
I was gonna say, I think just for all artists, you know, the thing I always tell them is that there's always kind of three stages of artistic, you know, growth. You know, is there's imitation, there's emulation, and then there's innovation. So we all start off with imitation. Imitation is, you know, I want to rap like Jay-Z.
Right.
Emulation is I want to rap as good as Jay-Z.
Mm-hmm.
Innovation is I want to sound like myself.
Right.
That's when you reach innovation. You know what I mean? And I think definitely just in the case of me and Pooh, I think definitely the listening was just, you know, it was a love letter to Tribe and Native Tongues,
right,
you know what I mean?
Right.
And Slum by extension. But, you know, I think, you know, Minstrel Show, Get Back, though around that time, that's to me when I think we really found who we were as artists. Mm-hmm. And we, you know, we sounded like us, you know, to me.
Yeah, it's an interesting point you bring up. Like, you know, it's almost like, you know, when you release your first album, they're saying like, oh, Little Brother's like the next Native Tongues or the next Tribe Called Quest, versus like now where people are like, Little Brother is the first Little Brother.
Right.
You know what I mean? So it's kind of that same point of like what you're talking about, you know, innovation, emulation,
mm-hmm.
et cetera.
Yeah.
So, all right. There it is, Slum Village. Fantastic volume. What? All right, next up, Pooh, we looked at your tweets and you controversially like Nas. It was written better than Illmatic. And this is the Get On Down clear vinyl reissue. So I got to hear this. You said Street Dreams is a cut. We're going to play that. But I want to hear the argument of why this is your favorite Nas album.
Man, ain't no argument for me. I mean, for me, I just... The way this album was put together, for me, it's just, although I love Illmatic, make no mistake about it.
Of course.
It's just this album, it put Nas in another category for me. It was like, you know, the Illmatic was like underground success story. It was,
mm-hmm.
you know, young kid do well, but this just showed like his elevation and from the production to how the songs were structured to, you know, his content was always me. It just, this album just really spoke to me. I can vividly remember riding on my bike around where I grew up in Reston, Virginia. Well, I was in high school at the time, Reston, Virginia, and just playing this album on tape, on the Walkman, just riding around, just countless hours, just letting the auto reverse flip back and forth. And it was just this album, man. People want to assassinate my musical character because I do pick this album over Illmatic, but I mean, not saying Illmatic isn't great, it is, but this this is, you know, this is the last of the best Nas albums right here for me.
What are your thoughts?
Funny? Yeah, I think Nas, it was written is almost like his love sexy, right? It's like, depending on how you see it, it's either, you know how they would say love sexy, and I know Warren, like you get it, it's like either that's the last of the good ones or it's the first of the bad ones, you know what I mean? Depending on how you see it. But nah, with It Was Written, man, that was a record that, you know, I understood in time. At the time when it came out, I was just like, yeah, because it dropped on the same day as Stakes Is High. And that was that, you know, that to me was like, if you ever want to look at, you know, the moment of kind of civil war, so to speak, in hip hop, you know, that was it. Because if you got into those at that point, those are two albums that dropped from two well-respected artists on the same day. And they had, you know, very divergent sounds. And depending on which one you got into, like if you like It Was Written, then that led you further down the road of like Rough Riders, Rockefeller, you know what I mean? If you were into Stakes Is High, that led you more towards Raucous, towards Slum, towards Hip Hop Psych, you know, no pun intended, you know what I mean? you know, it led you to that. And so that was kind of the start of a divide, you know, for me. And you almost kind of had to damn near pick a side, you know what I mean?
Right.
And so with Nas, It Was Written, I was like, all right, this is cool. But now later on, I totally understand why he had to make that record, because had he not made it, he would have just been another, you know, early 90s MC. Yeah, he could have been Mike Geronimo or Curious, you know what I'm saying?
Or Big L.
Big L, totally. Yeah, and I mean, in all respect to them, but, you know, but his trajectory could have been different. And the interesting thing about this, like with this remix, I didn't even notice until we had Steve Stout on QLS, like, it was like a year or so ago. And I didn't notice until he said, I was like, damn. So he was like, man, with that Street Jeans remix with R. Kelly, he said, you know, that is what we wanted to get that out first so that we could beat Big to the punch, because Big did Fucking You Tonight.
Right.
And that record did nothing. You know what I mean?
Right.
And I was like, damn, you right. Like, I didn't. The Street Jeans remix did. It killed it. You know what I mean? Yeah. The R. Kelly feature. Yeah. Like, I was like, damn, it's Fuck You Tonight. That was a mean record. Yeah, I mean, it wasn't going to get no radio play, but. That shit was a mean record, and man, the remix kind of killed that. And Steve brought that up, and I thought that was really interesting.
Yeah, a couple of points I'll touch on. Fucking You Tonight has a bizarre line where R. Kelly says, "B.I.G.
B.I.G. Bring that ass to me."
Whoa.
You know, what's interesting about Stakes Is High, man, is that, like, I look at that as, like, the last album of the golden era of hip-hop, because it pretty much was, like, the turning point where, like, this is the last time. I mean, even De La got a little more open to making commercial records post Stakes Is High. So I feel like Stakes Is High is that point where everything just stopped. It was like, all right, this is the last statement on a major label about the state of hip-hop. Mm-hmm. You know what I mean? Like, the rules are done. All that stuff that you're not supposed to do in terms of, like, you know, making commercial records or what you talk about, et cetera. All that shit's out the window now. And I feel like that was the last statement that was made at the expense of a label. Go ahead.
I think what Phonte said, like, nail on the head as far as, you know, the dividing line. And with you go Rockefeller with Nas, you go more Far Side. Or
Raucous.
You know. And both paths were good, but to lend to what Pooh was saying about this being the best Nas album, or better, not best, but better than, you know, his first, I think the main thing with this album is there was more commercial song structure. There were hooks. There was, you know, it was, you know, it was more, it was a more developed,
it was songwriting.
Yeah, it was songwriting. It was a developed album. And like Phonte had brought up is, you know, you have to develop as an artist, you know, and you can, you have to move forward, and kind of like, and you see an obvious example of this is, you know, De La. With De La's album, they start and you have to grow as an artist. And I think that I hear what Pooh's saying about Nas. I definitely, I'm not necessarily agreeing with you.
No. I can stay on this table.
I'm
alone,
not necessarily, you know, agreeing with you on that.
I know this brother. Me and this brother go back 20 years. This has been a hill he has been ready to die on for the past 2 decades.
I will say,
hey, there's no getting him off this hill.
I will say the message with the Sting sample is probably my favorite Nas song.
That was the one for me, because when I heard that, I was like, hell yeah. Because the thing with If I Ruled the World, and we even talked about this like when we had Steve on QLS, it was one of those records. It kind of put me in the mind frame of like Sunshine by Jay-Z and like Pizzo. Right. I know like y'all get the, where you have all the ingredients that on paper, it sounds like, okay, this is hip hop. Like, I mean, if you look at I Ruled the World, I mean, listen, you got Lauren singing the hook.
Yeah.
And this is, if you just look at the song on paper, we got Lauren singing the hook, who at that time, Lauren, everyone loved Lauren. She could do no wrong. Right. You got, you know, a Houdini sample.
Right. Yep.
You got a Curtis Blow interpolation. Yeah. So on paper, it's like, this is the most hip hop thing ever. And then you hear the song and it's like, but not like that.
but it gets the dance floor.
I was, and like Sunshine was
the same thing. Like Sunshine by Jay-Z. You got the rocking it sample. You know what I mean? All it, but it's just, it didn't come together right.
For the record,
Sunshine was way more cringeworthy.
Absolutely.
I love the Fearless Four sample though on that. I was a huge that sample was the rocking it sample.
Yeah, the rocking it.
I hear you. I'm not gonna.
And then you got Babyface on the hook singing a Jammin' Lewis song. I'm like, that was rough. It was rough.
All right, there it is. Nas, it was written.
I was gonna save it, but I never drank the D'Angelo Kool-Aid.
Right. Wow. Let's save. Yeah, we need, come on. Hey, bro, we need this take. Come on, baby.
All right, so yeah,
the tracks are hot, but the hits are hotter.
All right, next up we have Phonte off your Instagram 10 album challenge, D'Angelo Voodoo LP. And this is a crazy import with some clear vinyl. That's kind of cool.
Wow.
Nice.
Good.
Yeah. All right. So your cut was the root. And hopefully this plays the right side because I can't hear what I'm doing. But tell us about this. I mean,
man. First off, the root, those drums have been jacked like so heavy. Like all my producer homies at the time, the Voodoo album was just a treasure trove of drums. Yeah. The Chicken Grease snare in particular was the snare that was, it defined a whole era. The Trackmaster Spanish guitar and Chicken Grease snare clap, like that was in that's Fatty Girl. That's like 80 fucking songs, right?
Yes.
but the root. I just always loved that record. I just thought it was a gorgeous song. And in terms of sequence and a record, I always liked that you always felt like you have to have whatever your side two is, you got to start off side two with a heater, you know what I mean?
Right, right.
And so, you know, it was just like, you know, like Slum part two or side two rather of Fantastic Starts With Fall in Love. What's the other one? Midnight Marauders starts off side two with Electric Relaxation.
Mm-hmm.
And then, you know, Voodoo side two of that, you know, it starts with the root. And so just beautiful song. I just love that fucking record. I mean, I can't really say much else about it.
Let me pose a question to the group. When you first saw the Untitled video, did you think they were going to show his junk?
This was TV back then. You know what I'm saying? TV now?
TV now.
You might get it.
And they'll blur it out. They might blur it out, but you would see
after
it.
After they show it initially, like, then they'll blur it out.
They're really panning down right now. Like, this is... All right.
I have to say that I never drank the D'Angelo Kool-Aid. I never was a D'Angelo fan. I thought it was good. I thought, you know, I liked it, but I would never... At that point, I was coming from an ear of the party DJ ear, and to me, like, the last good slow song, because I was thinking party, was the old Jodeci record or something. That was it. After Jodeci, I didn't want to hear
any other. You had your club ear on.
There was no R&B.
There was no R&B slow songs.
R&B died after 95.
After Jodeci was it. I don't want to hear any of that. I want to hear Banger or Jodeci. That was it. If you didn't have a Banger, and I would listen to albums like, okay, that's good. Okay, that's going to be the third single. Like, that was my ear. That was my ear. So D'Angelo came around, I was just like, yeah, okay, you're not Jodeci.
Damn.
I'm sorry. That was
come on, Devil's Pie.
The remix, yes, but still, it was a warm-up banger. Like, you know, as people are walking in.
Devil's Pie. It's not a highlight club record. Yeah. If you drop Devil's Pie at 12 o'clock, you're clearing the floor.
Yeah. That's true. Yeah, I mean,
it's still a great record. Yeah. The Root, man. This whole album. I mean, the thing I liked about D'Angelo was that he sounded like a church dude that just grew up on hip hop. Yeah. And he reminded me of so many of like homies I went to school with. You know, I had homies that played in the church and, you know, dudes that were preacher's kids and, you know, lived in church all the time, either like playing drums or playing instruments. But when they wasn't in church, you know, we was listening to Wu-Tang, we was listening to Nas, we was listening to Big, you know what I mean? So, to me, the thing that really spoke to me with D'Angelo was that he sounded like those guys that I grew up with, you know? He spoke to that experience of being like a preacher's kid, but still also having, I guess, that pull of the secular world and still wanting to exist in that way as well. And you know, man, it really connected with me. And you know, that Voodoo record, I mean, I played the words off that whole album.
I let it slide. I just always remember every time I hear something off this album, I remember a story that Amir Questlove told one time. He was talking about they were on tour for this album, and D'Angelo heard Halle Berry was coming to the show. And said he just started doing a whole bunch of push-ups and shit doing sound. Yeah. So he got the extra pump when Halle showed up. He just comes across as somebody who would do some shit like that. That's why.
Yeah, especially at the way he did it. I mean, because you got to think about, and I've only met D'Angelo once, and it was very brief. It wasn't, you know, but just from all, you know, account from people that have known him, you know, everyone says that he's pretty much a really shy, kind of withdrawn person, you know what I mean? So you got to think, for someone to be a shy, withdrawn person, to be like this kind of shy church kid, a chubby kid, to all of a sudden in what, like 6 months, you turn into goddamn Morris Chest Pigs, nigga? Like, you turn into goddamn Shamar Elba out this bitch, nigga? Like, your brain is not ready to process all attention, you know what I'm saying? Yeah. Like, that's a big leap, you know? You know, I think his story is something that, you know, I mean, it's a success story, but in some ways, it can also be a cautionary tale. Sure. You know what I mean?
Sure. I could see Phonte turn into Idris Elba after this whole thing's over.
Hey, listen, man. Come out with my Rona body.
Rona body. Love that. The Rona body.
All right. There it is. D'Angelo. Voodoo.
This is the final boarding call for flight 1259 departing from Los Angeles. Destination to St. Louis. Thank you.
The track listing's all fucked up on this because I'll tell you about it in a second.
That's the 25th anniversary one?
Yeah, yeah.
Oh, yeah. Them first four tracks don't count.
What? Oh, they put new jams on there?
Yes. They put new shit on there. Yeah.
At the beginning?
Yeah, man. No. That's what I said. Them first four don't count, bro.
You throw them at the end.
All right. All right, you ready?
All right, let me do the cut. Hold on.
Pizzo say one of my new shit.
No.
Not now, nigga. We ain't come here for that.
We didn't come not come here for that.
All right, Ice Cube Death Certificate, 25th Anniversary Edition. This is what it's supposed to look like right here, but This is a new reissue of 25th Anniversary from Urban Legends. And it's got some bonus tracks on here, which we were just talking about. New material.
The real death certificate starts at the funeral, people.
Yes.
It starts at the funeral.
So we're going to check out My Summer Vacation. Pooh, this is one of yours. Because you said, let me read what you wrote on Twitter. You said, listen, man, I know people know Ice Cube now more for what he does in Hollywood, but he might have had the greatest 3-album run in rap history, America's Most Wanted, Kill It Will, Death Certificate, The Predator. So tell us about this.
For me, first of all, the people I looked up to as writers are storytellers. I love storytellers. And the pictures that Cube painted, it might be the reason why I believe deep down in my heart that I might be from the West Coast. It's because of the pictures that Cube painted. But just with these albums, man, I mean, from a production standpoint, how he started off with America's Most and he went to the East Coast and got with the Bomb Squad. And then he took his squad, Sir Jinx, Pooh, and they came back west for a Death Certificate and they created their
own version. Bomb Squad.
Yeah, their own Bomb Squad. They were inspired by. And this is how he was able to continue that through the Predator as well. It's just the storytelling in these, just the production, the aggressiveness, the energy, just all those different things, man. That's what the 3-album plus 1 EP run that Cube had, man, is it's unmatched. Like
100%.
I think people, even at the time, I don't think nobody really expected, you know, when he came out, for him to do what he did. Just coming from NWA, what that sounded like, and then for him to go totally another direction. It was just, plus the pen was still, you know, legit. It was amazing, man. Like, I still listen to these 3 albums like they came out last week.
Yep.
And the thing with that, too, is like, it also showed, first and foremost, I always have said, if Ice Cube would have died after Death Certificate, he would have been Tupac.
Right.
Ooh. Good point.
You know what I mean? Like, for him to get cut off right then, I mean, it would have been, and also you can maybe say if Pac would have lived, he could have been Cube. You know what I mean? Because I definitely saw Pac going more into the movies and acting and stuff like that. But the thing with Cube, with this song in particular, to me, this is when Cube became a screenwriter.
Right.
Because My Summer Vacation is the record I'd listen, like, whenever young MCs, like, want, ask me about, like, records of study, whatever. I'm like, dude, go listen to My Summer Vacation. That shit is a movie. Every verse tells a part of the story. Yeah. It's got everything: rising action, climax, falling action. Like, I mean, that is a perfectly executed screenplay in 3 minutes and change.
Yeah, I would say that these albums are very cinematic. They're like movies. I mean,
absolutely.
To the point where even the skit. I mean, they're produced in a way, you know, starting from that Bomb Squad production on America's Most Wanted, and even into the next three. They're done in a way where it's like one long piece of music with the skits, like, really sew it together.
Yeah.
And it's just like one big cinematic event, and it was like an annual thing. And I remember, like, when the new Ice Cube thing came out, you were like, oh shit, you know, and like,
It was like that until, I mean, because the thing too, like, kind of the echo what Pooh was saying with his pen, Ice Cube going solo, it really highlighted how much NWA needed him.
Yes.
Like, because when Niggas for Life came out, it was like, you know what I mean? Like, they kind of just became silly and over the top. And Cube was really kind of the grounding, like, you know, he was the intelligence, you know what I mean? Like, he was kind of the analyst, but without him, you didn't really have that balance, you know what I mean? And you really heard that on Niggas for Life.
And with those 3 albums, you also hear the hunger. The Cube still, like, he was going for his.
Yes.
It almost sounded like he felt like he had something to prove.
Oh, totally.
He did.
But even, I mean, like, still, like, the you know, Death Certificate, you're like, okay, dude, we believe you. Like, we understand. But, like, he just kept going. And, I also to echo what you guys saying about the like the three album run, I would put it up against, and Pooh might you know kick me out of the shot after I say this, but you know 3 Feet High and Rising. You knew I was gonna say it, right? Yeah. Like, oh, Dead Mistakes is high. It's like the same type of thing. I'm not gonna say, you know, I'm not gonna say, you know, which is better. I mean, I was a huge Cube fan. I'm in Vegas, so you know.
Okay, so for me, so my question, y'all, when did you jump off the Cube train? Like you were saying, Pizzo, like, you know, it was always the Cube thing. All so right. For me, like, I noticed, like, because Cube was one of the greatest. He was one of the greatest, like, people that could, like, pull a. He would switch it up, like, every record. He played, like, every card. So, like, every album was a new Cube. So, like, America's Most Wanted, that was Gangsta Cube.
Right.
And then, like, Death Certificate was Muslim Cube.
Right, yeah.
And then, you know, Predator was Skater Cube.
Right.
And then Lethal Injection was G-Funk Cube.
Yeah.
And then War and Peace was Magician Cube. Like, it just went to places that we, I was like, okay, what the fuck is going on here? Like, so, when Mr. Right. Short Cop showed up, I was like, okay, I think this may be my last stop on the train.
Man, it hurts, because I mean, like those first four albums are like religion, you know what I mean? Like, they're good. And even Lethal Injection, like, I started to see him, like, go a little bit, but I still like Lethal Injection, but...
No, Really Dope was still a record. Really Dope was dope.
Yeah, tons of records on there,
Lethal Injection is definitely G-Funk Cube, but...
Yeah. It's still strong, but
the thing is, when you listen to G-Funk Cube, and then you go to Yay Yay Cube,
that's it.
You appreciate G-Funk Cube even more.
Like, you hit the nail on the head.
In that bag.
The minute he said Yay Yay is, I was like, done.
That was the line of demarcation. Like,
I was done before Lethal Injection. I think Predator was the Love Sexy.
Yes.
Lethal Injection came, like, I'm good. I'm done with this guy.
Yeah, but
I like West Side Predator. Connection.
Oh, I did. I was never feeling West Side.
I liked West Side Connection.
Yeah, so it's interesting to hear, because y'all are in Vegas, y'all on the West Coast. Yeah. I was grabbing one of my homies. Yeah. You worked that record?
I worked West Side Connect, never liked it.
Yeah, it was to us on the East. Like, I was my man DJ Artistic that I was I shouted out earlier, that he does his IG live. He does like West Side Wednesdays and stuff, and he was just playing a bunch of shit. Like, I mean, he played like an hour of West Coast records I've never heard in my life, and he was playing stuff off like the first like West Side Connection album, and it was just over here on the East Coast in the South. Those records, they didn't really translate, but out west where y'all was at, I mean, them shits was going off. And so I was just curious to know, what was it like around in the out there for y'all?
I think the whole West Coast, that whole era, you know, I think gave people on the West Coast something to claim, because New York hip hop was such a New York thing. I mean, I don't care what anyone said, it was such a New York thing. And the West Side Connection and all that stuff just gave us something to cling to and say, this is us. But personally, being, you know, Vegas, basically on the West Coast, for me, West Coast love was going, it was great, great, great. And then right after Predator, or right in the middle of Predator, I just, I hid. And then the Dog Pound album came out, and I was like, what's going on? Hey. The Dog Pound album woke me up again. But in between there, I was like, I don't want to hear any of this.
Wow.
We be clubbing.
Wow. And we be clubbing.
Pushing weight.
Push rounds like weight. I wasn't mad at We Be Clubbing. We Be Clubbing was like a dope record. It was a dope club record. And it was like in the club.
The club. That's it.
I think where we kind of got a little rocky, by the time you got the You Can Do It, Put Your Back Into It, that was okay. I was like,
those three. Wait. Is that a separate record? Wait, you got Pushing Weight, you got
You Can We Be do Clubbing, it, and You Can clubbing. Do It. Yeah.
Well, it's kind of like when you like hear
Unholy Trinity.
When you hear, you know, you hear, you know, One Love Nas, and then all of a sudden you hear Firm Biz. You're like, yeah, okay, I'm done. Like, all right,
fair enough. But those records were such a far departure, man. Like, I mean, he was talking about real shit and like had the cinematic albums, and then he just comes with Yay Yay, and I was just like, dude, I'm
see, but see, that's that also coincides with the time he really, really got into Hollywood. Like,
true.
He had dipped his toes in it, but that's when he was really in it. So obviously the content wasn't going to be as aggressive, as militant, as, you know, as
Death Certificate, a Predator. Right, yeah.
Right. Yeah, yeah, it couldn't be any of those. So
true.
I remember I had a back in one of the Gavin conventions, I had a long conversation with Positive K. Yeah, and we were talking, and I think I was, you know, I was hardcore underground, keep it real. Yeah. That was all day for me. And we were talking about MC Light. I was like, what happened to MC Light? MC Light this, MC Light that. And I remember we were sitting in this room, and he looked at me and was like, you know, bro, he's like, you know, after you make a record and you become, you know, semi-popular and everything's going well, like, you know, you move to a different house, you're in a different neighborhood. He goes, dude, you're just not as, like, it's just a whole different environment. He's like,
you're not the same person anymore.
He's like, you're not as hungry. You're not talking about this, that, and the other, because you're not doing this, that, and the other anymore. So he goes, you just kind of grow out of it. He goes, everyone, and I never forget when it was so honest. He was just telling me, like, yo, man, you just grow out of it. Like, I don't live in that house anymore. I don't take the train. I have my car now. Like, I have, you know, I got three kids now. Like, it's, and I think that's a perfect example of what happened to Cube. And, you know, he's had great success. And I love what he's doing as an entrepreneur and stuff. But like you said, those three albums, man. Woo.
That was it. Yeah. That was it.
All right.
That was it.
There it is. Ice Cube, Death Certificate. Sorry, Cube. Sorry.
Yo, this is Mood Control. Saying you might as well pay attention if you can't afford free speech.
All right, next up, Parliament, Funkinteleki versus the Police, Placebo Syndrome. Phonte, this is one of yours.
And yes.
Georgia Ann Muldrow picked this album when we had her on the show.
Are you serious?
Yeah,
yep. She
did. Oh, wow. I got to go back and listen to watch her episode, man. I love Georgia.
Yeah. So, I mean, we're on the subject of Cube, and he owes a lot to this record, clearly.
Man, listen.
This whole catalog, this whole George Clinton catalog.
I'll say before you even get started, I say I wasn't a huge Parliament or Funkadelic fan at all until Cube. Then I was like, can we come back? I mean, my parents didn't have a lot of Funkadelic. They didn't have a lot of records, and I didn't have a lot of money to spend on, you know,
experimenting.
Yeah, so I didn't become a big Funkadelic fan or even know what was going on until Cube.
Wow. Yeah. I was, I think for me, Digital Underground definitely were, you know, they were a big influence as well in terms of kind of being a bridge. So with me, my thing with Parliament Funkadelic, my uncle Brad, he was a huge P-Funk fan. Like, he was a huge P-Funk fan. And so I grew up like listening to all this stuff and seeing as a kid, the album covers would just bug me out. You know what I mean? Like,
that's so
like
crazy.
You know what I'm saying? Like, looking at, like, I remember, you know, being at my aunt's house and seeing the Motor Booty Affair, and like, you know, and like opening it up and seeing all the underworld. I was like, what the fuck is this shit? You know what I mean? Yeah. And so, like, when I would hear the records, and I always associated it as my parents' music. Like, this is something that older people listen to. But when I started listening, you know, I got more into hip hop. And particularly when I heard Cube rhyme over this for doing dumb shit, it just put those records in a totally, it put them in a new context for me.
And
that helped me kind of like what Warren was saying. It helped me understand just how fucking dope that shit was. You know what I mean?
Yeah, I didn't get into Parliament till I was older. But I mean, I could definitely tell they were doing a lot of drugs.
Lots of them.
Yeah, drugs was at an abundance. Uh-huh. And obviously, when you go back and listen, when you're older, you start noticing, you know, all of the things that the different artists you listen to borrow, you know, sample for their music. And it definitely gives you a different impression of the music, and it makes you want to dig deeper. And that's what it ended up having me do, is dig a lot deeper than I would have dug previously once I started hearing all of the different pieces that the artists that I listened to or were listening to took from them.
Right.
It's crazy. George Clinton, Parliament Funkadelic is probably the most picked artist on this show. I mean,
it is.
George is probably the most. And like, it's interesting that you said that about the album covers, Phonte, because Georgia also said that the album covers used to scare her when she was a kid. And I think Dell said that too, if I remember. I think Dell might have said something about that too. So it's interesting that like everybody who kind of grew up with these records in their home and like seeing those album covers really had an impact, you know. And I think, you know, for me, I didn't have Parliament records in my home, but what like the album covers that scared me were mm-hmm. like Kiss and Iron Maiden. Like I'd see like
the
I'd
metal see shit
and I'd be like, oh, this is, what is this? You know, this is
yeah. But, yeah. And P-Funk too for me was just a thing of you could turn it down a little bit, Pizzo. It was kind of loud. But I think for me, a big part that kind of is that gets, you know, overlooked is just George's strength as a lyricist and as a just a poet. I mean, he was doing shit with words. I mean, that, you know, that predated rap, you know, fucking, you know, however 20 years or so. And, you know, man, I really like listen to, you know, like Motor Booty Affair, This Fishtail Begins Where Most Fishtails End. You know what I mean? Like just all the puns and stuff mm-hmm. that he would just throw out there and you'd be like, what the fuck? You know, people keep waiting on the change, ain't got sense enough to come in out of the rain. Like that was, wordplay, you know, hearing it. Yeah, the wordplay was like stupid as hell. So as I think he's really unheralded in that sense.
Yeah. All right, there it is. Parliament Funkatelic LP. All right, next up we got the Vinyl Me Please reissue Fancy of Doggy Style. And Pooh, your cut on here is The Shiznit. And this is one of the best, this is like one of the best selling rap albums of all time, like 11 million copies or something. I mean, what else is up there with this?
I think Nas, right?
Nah, it had to be Outkast, Love Below, Speak About.
Oh, because that counted as two.
Yeah.
That counted as two, right?
The buzz, I was doing street promotions around this time, and the buzz for this album was insane.
Yes. This, and again, this is another one that owes a lot to Parliament, Funkadelic, George.
Oh Clinton, yeah,
it's a whole lot.
Yeah,
but W balls.
The crazy thing about this album, a couple different things, but this was the first CD I ever owned,
really,
in life. My mom had bought me a stereo for my 14th birthday, mm-hmm. and she bought me a stereo and she bought me a CD. And her boyfriend at the time, they went to the store to get the CD. And my mom told me that they were kind of deciding between, my mom was deciding between getting me a Tevin Campbell CD mm-hmm. or the Snoop album.
Wow.
And she got me the Snoop album because she liked, what was the singer? What's My Name?
What's my name? Yeah.
But of course she had only heard the radio version. So right. When I get the CD, I'm opening it up. I'm excited. She like, oh, play my jam. And then she heard it and was like, oh, hell nah. Should have got you the Tevin Campbell CD.
Name?
Exactly. But yes, she was not ready for that. But nah, this album for me, man, this is, you know, I was 13, 14, and this album, it just really spoke to me on the level of West Coast. It brought something different for me from the West Coast. Like obviously, I mean, just once Dre started his own individual journey, it just changed how I listened to West Coast music. And I love this song, and Shiznit so much, because I heard the story that this was like a freestyle, mm-hmm. when they just kept it. And it kind of reminds me of when we made For You off the Listening. For You was a mic check. Like we had just changed the mics up and we were just spitting random verses to get a mic check. And them random verses ended up becoming For You. And so that, like, For You always reminded me of this song particularly. But this album really introduced people to Rage, mm-hmm. RBX, mm-hmm. Dog Pound. Mm-hmm. Like, it was Snoop's debut album, but it gave you so many introductions to other artists that, but how they intertwined and meshed them together was beautiful, that you never took your eyes off of this being Snoop's debut album, but you also got introduced to these other artists as well, and, you know.
So tell us your G's Up, Hose Down story. about your friends.
Man, listen. Listen. I wish I could find that nigga to this day.
So first, context. So give some context, because later pressings didn't have Jesus hose down.
Yeah, right. Later pressings, after the first pressing, they didn't have it. So I had an original pressing, and we were talking about, you know, our favorite albums in college, my freshman year in college, and we were in the dorm. And I bring over Snoop, and I come, and the guy I was talking with, he has Snoop, and I'm like, man, but yo, I'm looking for the song, and his doesn't have it. So I go get mine, and I'm playing it. And I didn't notice until like probably like 6 months later that my my CD no longer had G's Up Hose Down on it.
Man, since you with the switcheroo.
He hit me with the switcheroo, and he didn't come back to school. He did not come back to school. I was so hot. I was so hot. Like, it took me years.
So funny.
Phonte finally sent me that song so I could put it into my playlist, but I didn't have that song for years because I didn't know. You know, that was my first time learning about represses. I learned a hard, tough lesson about represses that day.
I can only imagine you guys in a small dorm room, like, intently listening to the CD and the guy going, yo, is that free food over there? And you're like, oh, my God.
Right.
Yeah,
I've got to go to the bathroom.
I got. Yeah, he got. That song, that particular song, man, just how it was done coming in from the skit to the just. I mean, that represents Snoop. Like, right. It's still who he is to this day. Yeah. So, this is definitely one of my favorite Snoop album. But one of my favorite West Coast albums. Period.
Doggy style. I think Doggy Style, for me, you know, whenever people talk about, you know, debut albums, to me, Doggy Style is still like probably the greatest hip hop debut, like, in hip hop for me.
Oh, yeah. I mean,
people talk about Nas and Illmatic, and I mean, Illmatic is, I mean, it is what it is. It's a classic, but Doggy Style does not get its flowers in terms of, for that to be your first album and for that to be as polished and as thorough as it was, like, man, that shit was that was once in a lifetime shit.
Yeah. Have a radio hit, have the lyrics that he had, and mm-hmm. like who was saying, introducing the whole crew like he did. You know, it was basically a sophomore album for Dre. Like, it was just like, whoa. Yeah.
And Dre changed the landscape on mixes.
Yes.
You had to step your mix game up. I remember Puffy telling the story about when they heard this album. How Puffy, the first thing he said when he heard this album was like, yo, we got to step our mixes up.
Yeah.
Like, because the album was so pristine and bang.
Yeah.
It was so clean, so loud. Yeah. So just everything you wanted in the album.
Yeah.
And then the ironic thing about that is that after he stepped his mixes up a few years later, you have The Firm, which is pretty much Dre chasing Puffy.
Right.
You know what I mean? Like, it was, you know what I mean? That was them trying to take the Bad Boy formula and just sing over 80 shit and that wasn't it, you know what I mean?
Yeah, that's interesting. Yeah, and I mean, and coupled with all those facts you just mentioned about the album, it was also a massive success. So, like, it was still a, you know, I don't want to say underground, it's not the right word, but it was still a hardcore hip-hop album.
Yep.
And it was also one of the biggest selling albums of all time. It's very rare that you can, like, get those two things to line up, you know?
Yeah.
Yeah.
The anticipation for that album was so crazy. You know, I still remember it. Like, I was hyped when my mama walked in with that Snoop CD. I ain't gonna lie. I was hyped. I ain't want to play it for, but I was hyped. I was hyped about it.
You didn't walk around the house going, "What's my motherfucking name?"
I would be toothless right now if I did. I have all wood teeth like George Washington.
Yep. All right, there it is. Snoop Dogg, Doggy Style. All right, this is the last one of yours, Phonte. You got Radiohead Kid A, another one from your Instagram batch. And
yeah, crazy, man.
This pressing is an error pressing, so check this out. Like, the label is, like, affixed to the vinyl.
Wow.
And, like, I bought it at a record store when it came out, like, the year it came out, and I paid, like, $55 for it. And I got home, and it was like this. I was so pissed. Now I'm happy because I'm like, oh, this is unique.
That's, you know, a collector's item. Yeah, man.
Yeah, yeah.
So I don't know, but yeah. So your cut was
optimistic.
Yeah. So yeah, this man, Radiohead. I'll let you. I don't know where to even start here, but
yeah, man. So I think with this record, so this was kind of the record that really got me. It led me in another path, I guess. You know, I had first heard, I think the first time I heard Radiohead or heard Tom York rather, it was on the Uncle Science Fiction record, the DJ Shadow joint, the Rabbit in Your Headlights joint.
Yes.
And I was like, man, this shit is crazy. Like, I love this. And I had a buddy at the time that was working in a record store in the mall, and he used to hook me up with shit. You know what I'm saying? I come in and just slide him a couple dollars and, you know, I could, you know, have my way with the stove. and so, you know, because at that time, you know, you couldn't really experiment, kind of going to what, you know, what you were saying earlier, Warren, about just how, you know, if you had $10 or $20, you know, that was an investment and that shit was a decision, you know what I mean? Yeah. And so even though there may have been other kinds of music that you may have been interested in, you know, you got to stick with your sure shot. Yeah, you got to stick with what you know, with your budget. Yeah. And so thankfully, with the help of my morally unscrupulous friend at the record store.
We all have one.
We all had one. Hell, I was one. But, but you know what I mean? But that enabled me. And I just saw that OK Computer was on the end cap. And I was like, man, let me just try this. And I just grabbed OK Computer. Don't cost you nothing. I'm like, let me just try it. And that shit opened up with Airbag. And I was like, holy shit. Like, this is fucking dope. It kind of had like a hip hop feel to it with the drums. I was like, this shit is hard. And so that made me a Radiohead fan with OK Computer. And
from,
yes, indeed. Yes.
I had to do it once for sure.
Yeah, OK Computer is what kind of made me a fan. So I heard that one. And then I went and got the Bends. And I was like, okay, this is dope. You know, the Bends was dope. So then when I heard Kid A was coming, I remember it got a 5-star review in Rolling Stone at the time, I want to say.
Right.
And that was, you know, something that was rare. And so I went and got it and just played it. And, you know, the opening song is Everything in His Right Place.
Right.
And I just remember listening to that. I was like, yo, like, how crazy is it? I just thought it was so wild to start an album in such a kind of quiet and reserved way, you know, particularly in a lot of rock albums, you try to start off with like some big, loud, kind of boisterous shit.
Yeah.
But that really opened the album in just a very quiet way. I was like, holy shit. And so that album, man, I mean, Kid A was, I still think Kid A is the album, like a lot of the rock critics, you know, now they kind of say it's the album that, you know, it gets some of a bad rap. I think it's the album that got black people in the Radiohead. Yeah, you know what I mean? I think that was the record. Like all my homies, like you talk, you know, from Glasper to, you know, Amir, like Kid A is the album that for us, like the hip hop generation, that was the one that got us, you know what I mean? And Optimistic, you know, again, that was the song that opened up side two.
Right.
And, you know, it has like a drum break at the end of it that I was like, what the fuck? This shit is hard. And yeah, man, this album, a lot of memories, this record. Me and Pooh used to, we would be on the road and it was like my turn to drive. Mm-hmm. I just put on Kid A because I knew that was going to put everybody to sleep. So everybody else, they be asleep and I just be driving and I'd be cool. You know what I'm saying? And that was it. It was kind of my zone out record.
It's interesting, like the, you know, that's when they really started to embrace that electronic production technique more, more so than like the OK Computer, you know what I mean? The OK Computer had it too, but less, seems like there was more, I mean, for them to open without even any hard guitars on Everything in Its Right Place is just, you know.
Not even any hard drums, like it wasn't even really like hard drums on that record.
Yeah.
And yeah, man, but that record, Kid A for me, and also too, it really, kind of solidified for me just the belief in being able to make a hard pivot, you know what I mean? And, you know, being able, because that record sounded like nothing that they had done prior to that point. And it kind of solidified to me just the belief whenever people say, when you have your artists say, oh man, you know, the audience, they may not get it, the audience not going to get it. Man, if you don't have faith in the audience, you ultimately don't have faith in the art. Right. You know what I'm saying? Don't put it off on, oh, they won't get it. Nah, if that shit is right, they'll get it. You know what I'm saying? And I thought Kid A was a testament to that, of just going in a completely different path, but executing it at such a high level that you still are able to bring your audience along with you and take that chance.
Oh, yeah. All right. Bill, yeah. Does this resonate for you at all?
Yeah. I mean, for me, it's more nostalgic purposes.
I saw you getting sleepy, so...
Nah, not that. Like, real talk, I would be the only one when Phonte had to drive, I would be the only one that really could stay up with him, because no lie, like, back in college, we had a radio show on the campus radio together, and we didn't play no rap, no R&B, like, it was all what I called at the time weird shit. And like, that's what Tay ended up introducing me to, like, Beck, you know, just different artists, different genres of music that I had never even thought about listening to. And so when he would drive, he would play all the music we used to play on the show. So for me, it didn't bother me, because I can catch something like, oh, what's this? Oh, I need to get up on this. But this album in particular, this was the tour album, man. This was the album we ran, like, front to back, side to side, again and again and again and again and again. And I tried to listen to, like, the next Radiohead album. Like, I didn't go backwards.
Amnesiac is not, that's not the one. Like, that's...
I turned it off.
Kid B, essentially.
Yeah, that one's rough. Yeah. That one's rough.
It didn't hit the same, and I chalked it up to nostalgia. And so, and because of that, Kid A is the only Radiohead album I would ever listen to. Okay. Because the nostalgia is so strong with it.
All right, there it is.
Definitely got to give real quick props to college radio, because you're exact what you're saying. Like, back in those days, you didn't have money. So if you worked for a radio station, you got everything.
All the promos.
Yeah. Everybody here has done that.
That completely opens up your mind, because you're not limited by money. And it's kind of similar to what's happening now with
streaming services.
Spotify, whatever. My just quick example, my kid the other day, maybe about 2 months ago, came up to me. He's having and producing everything. He said, "Dad, you ever heard of Brandy?" I'm like, "Have I heard of Brandy?" I said, "You know what? You need to check out Monica, SWV, Jade," and he came
all
back
the way down there. Right?
He came back a couple days later, like, "This stuff's amazing." I'm like, "Man, get out of me with it."
That's something that I think the streaming services are having an effect on. They're pretty much erasing the context of what old and new is. There's there's no more old music. It's just music you know and music you don't.
There's no more black and white either.
There's no more black and white. There's now you're able to see, because they're putting it in the context of, you know, if you go to a playlist, you may hear, you know, a Foreign Exchange song or a Khalid song or whatever, right? Mm-hmm. Which is new, but you might hear that in the context of a fucking Eric Benet song
or a Brandy song,
you know what I mean? Right, it really blurs that line, and makes that connection in ways that we didn't have. And you know, my kids, my oldest son particularly, I mean, they're way more musically savvy than I was, and I think this generation as a whole are going to be way more musically savvy than we were, just because they have the ability to explore everything in a way that we just didn't.
All right, there it is. Radiohead, Kid A. Knock niggas out the box all the time. Just no more motherfucking rep. All right, Pooh, finally we have Raekwon, Only Built for Cuban Links, my favorite Wu-Tang album right here.
Yeah.
And, man,
I'm with you.
Oh, shit, you know what? That reminds me, I gotta bring out
the actual purple tape?
Purple tape. This is the get on down.
Yes, it is.
We'll put that right there. Incarcerated Scarface is a cut. Tell us about this magnum opus of an album.
This album here, man, this really solidified for me everything I feel about the Wu-Tang when I heard this album. You know, like everybody, well, not everybody, like most people, you know, when they first came out, I definitely was like, "Oh, what's this? This is crazy." Mm-hmm. And just how it was dirty. It was, you know, a whole bunch of people. They were rhyming. But when they got into the solos, like, I didn't really like Method Man's solo album. But when I got this one,
I like it.
When I got to this
one, you like who? You like Takao?
I love Takao. I was a.
Have this conversation.
Oh yeah. That's
we wear jeans.
I'm on Pizzo's side on that one, but yeah.
Oh my God! The first two people I've ever heard that say they like Takao.
Yeah. But sorry, I don't want to get off track.
It's all good.
We coming back to that though.
Yeah, we definitely circling back to that. Okay. For me, Ray and Ghost, they were the two most prolific, I say, MCs out of the crew, and they had the most energy and character to me, like. I didn't understand what the hell they were saying half the time or what they were talking about, but just the energy that which they delivered it. And then you go back and you re-listen to what Ray was saying, like his rhymes, man, he was so sharp with it, man. He was so sharp with it, man. Like, it's
Corolla,
so crazy.
Motorola holder. Like,
listen, crazy. But like this album, man, I think this was like they put it, RZA put it on the one with this one. I don't know what he was doing with drugs, what he was drinking, with they recording that, but everything just came together perfect for this one. And just the blend of introducing you to Ghostface throughout this album as well, like, was perfect to go into Ghostface album, man. Them two niggas was a group. at the end of the day, they was a group to me. But this record, I remember this record, Incarcerated Scarface. People don't believe me to this day. I heard this for the first time on radio, regular radio.
So did I.
Like,
college radio. Sorry.
Well, this is regular radio. Yeah. He was doing an interview when the album came out. Yeah. I don't know if it was WKYS or 93.9 in the DC area, but he was there doing the interview and he played this record. And when he played this record, I said, yo, I gotta have it. I gotta get it. I don't care. I gotta go find it. I gotta go get this album. This album right here is, like, I don't know. This is really what sold me on the Wu-Tang.
Yeah.
Is this album. Like, if it wasn't for this album, I don't know if I would have gotten to the rest of the members' albums. Because after that Method Man debacle.
Oh, well, hang on.
Let's talk about it.
The debacle that is Takao. Okay, that's the debacle.
What's the debacle?
Listen.
Okay, all right. Okay, even if you like. Okay, let's. Okay, let's draw some. Let's be. Okay, even if you like the album, all right. Mm-hmm. Even if you like Takao, can we at least agree that even if you like it, it's still the worst of the Wu-Tang solos?
No.
What's worse than Takao?
The Lex Diamond story, Raekwon.
No. Okay. All right. Okay. First run.
Man, Pizzo, you be careful. Okay. Pizzo knows some.
First run. Okay. We talking first run.
Okay. Actually, I like it better than ODB.
Hold on.
Because I think Meth is sharper. I thought Meth is sharper. Like Dirty is so like all over the place. So.
Yeah, I mean he's sharper lyrically. Yeah. Okay, no doubt. But the album, nigga, let me tell you something. Let's keep the hot takes coming, nigga. Dirty might be my favorite solo behind Cuban Links. I personally got Dirty over Liquid Swords.
Ooh.
Hot. Keep the tapes. Yes.
Getting blasphemous, man.
Nigga, let me tell you something.
It's Sunday, bro.
Bro, listen. Dirty, listen, man. You don't understand, man. We used to listen to that shit for football practice.
Yeah.
We used to be saying that, like, bro. Dirty,
I love it.
Dirty was my nigga,
I love it,
man.
Dude, I love those first, even Gravediggers, the first, like, eight albums.
Yeah.
All of it. I loved all of it. So, I mean, it's just, you know.
Okay, so from... again, party club DJ. That Method Man was it for me. Like he had, you know, girls liked them. He had the party cuts. Like, yes, this is here. As far as Wu-Tang, I was not a Wu-Tang fan until Raekwon. Raekwon, I was like, oh, let me go back and listen to what these dudes are doing. And then GZA, ODB. After that, maybe La the Dark Man, and that was it. I'm like, I'm done with you guys. Yeah.
So for me, Wu-Tang was it was very much like Pooh was saying it. So. I remember I went to the store and I bought crazy Jodeci Diary of a Mad Band and Wu-Tang the first album on the same day, right? Yeah. I bought like both of them and I remember buying Jodeci on tape and I had the Wu-Tang on CD, you know what I mean? And, you know, I remember putting the Wu-Tang joint in and listening to it. And I was like, this is a CD? Like, this shit sound like he recorded it off of them. Like, when Bring the Ruckus came, I was like, what the, yeah. what is this? Like, this is really the album?
Yeah,
so
yeah.
And so, yeah. yeah, so it was so fucking raw. And so, yeah. You know, I mean, Method Man, I love fucking Method Man, the song Method Man. Like, I love that shit. But yeah, Wu-Tang took a minute to kind of grow on me. And even with Cuban Links, you know, the first single that I heard that they used to play around with on Mix Show, they would play Glaciers of Ice.
Right.
And I did not like Glaciers of Ice at all. I was like, what the fuck is this? But it made sense once I got the album. It was a record that made sense in context. And once I heard the rest of the record, I was like, oh, okay, this is what it is. But nah, the first run of the Wu, like, I mean, the first Wu-Tang album, it had moments for me, and I was like, okay, this is dope, and I didn't get it 2 years later. But to Cal, man, I was like, yo, so y'all might remember this. So Pizzo and, yes. and but y'all might remember this. The moment I knew that something was off, do you remember the Vibe magazine review? I never get this. This was around the time they were doing the Month of the Man mm-hmm. joint, because yeah. it was Meth and it was Red. Yeah. And so they had they did a dual review of There's a Dark Side and Takao in Vibe. Mm-hmm. And they were talking about, you know, There's a Dark Side, and the reviewer, that I think it was Michael Gonzalez, I think, but he was just like, yeah, you know, the There's a Dark Side, this is all right, but Takao is incredible. And this, and so I read the review, I was like, holy shit, let me see. And then when I heard them goddamn albums, I don't think I ever trusted Vibe's word on shit again.
Hey, but you know what? I'm with Mike on that.
I was like, y'all niggas crazy. Like, what album is y'all here?
Nah, because
There's a Dark Side was the shit.
Nah, what the album is the shit?
Well, if we talk, I mean, that vocal shit. If I gotta pick one, I'm going with Muddy Waters. I mean, that's if we got
that's the one.
Okay. Yeah, that's the one. But yeah, so
yeah.
Nah, bro, that Takao album, I was like, okay, maybe I'm just not high enough for this, but nigga, no.
I don't know, maybe it's the age I was at, but, and I was also super Wu head. You know, like I said, I had Wu wear jeans. I literally found that shit at like Burlington Coat Factory and was like, shit, my size, and you know. I rocked that shit.
So rocked what it. Joints, okay, I got, so if y'all were both DJs, what jams was y'all running off the Cal? Because literally the only ones we ran was Bring the Pain,
uh-huh.
and
All I Need. Right?
I need Meth vs. Chef. I didn't
Meth
like
Chef is great.
Yeah, it Bring the Pain, Meth vs. Chef. Nigga, what you running off side to other than PLO style?
Oh, PLO style. Yeah, okay. I guess. See, that's the thing. Like, I never listened.
Someone is searching.
I was searching. I was pure party rock style DJ. Like, that was me. Party style DJ. That was all me.
What,
so,
the blood clot, sub crazy, all of this, man. Release your Delph.
Sub crazy. I didn't know. Nah. Release your Delph was like,
the whole thing, man.
I cannot believe all the years we've known each other that Pizzo is a Takao truther. I did not know this. I was not ready for this revelation today.
But I'm glad
the only guy I know that goes up for Takao, bro.
I'm glad you brought up the Month of the Man, though. I'm gonna flip the script.
Yes.
There it is.
Yes.
Yeah.
Month of the Man.
This is like before they were even like a group. You know what I mean?
Right.
Like, this is just Def Jam marketing. So.
Yes.
All right. We will settle this by instead talking about part two of
Yo, I feel like this is a whole nother podcast. Like,
yeah.
It's like tracking the downfall of kind of, because for me, again, when you talk about the first run of Wu albums, and big ups, I got to give props to like Inspect the Dex album, because it came late, you know what I mean? Or, you know, but that album was dope. Uncontrollable Substance was dope.
Oh, I didn't like that.
You ain't like Uncontrollable Substance?
No, that's when I felt, okay.
Go in.
I don't know, man. I didn't really, didn't have RZA beats or something. Like, wasn't it all?
RZA did a couple on there.
Yeah,
RZA did
that's,
a couple.
That's when RZA had started going into Bobby Digital Land, man. You
post
know?
Flood, the flood. There was the whole flood.
It was a flood. Yeah.
All right, let's not.
Yeah.
Right. No, So we have a whole podcast. This really could, okay. So I, one thing I got to know before we go, because okay, you didn't, because you niggas going up for the cow, so I got to know that. Like, look, what did, were your thoughts on the Mobilarity?
I don't like it. I only like the Raekwon Pete Rock sneakers song.
The sneakers joint.
That's it.
Okay. Okay. Yeah. All right. Just want to bring some semblance.
Got to double check now.
Yeah. And my man, yeah.
Make sure.
You want to make sure I didn't like it? Is that what? Okay.
All right. I need to bring some semblance of sanity back to this thing now. Okay. Okay. Yeah. Let's get a baseline going. All right. Okay.
Raekwon, only built for Cuban links.
Chapel Hill.
So
that'll be all right. So here we got your new album, May the Lord Watch, and we just hit play on side A, and it comes with, this is great because it comes with the Percy Miracles funeral program. So basically, like, you can, you know, the album credits and the story of which is brilliantly written here.
Thank you so much, man.
Yeah, I love it, and this is just great. And also, I like the little Photoshop here too. or is it, you know? This is great. So,
or is it?
Yeah, or is it? So first question is, can we expect a posthumous Percy Miracles album?
Man, the lane is wide open, you know. I've been talking to his estate, you know, trying to finalize some details and get into his vaults, you know what I mean? His estate is very litigious, you know what I mean? So, you know, we're trying, you know, there may be a documentary coming, you know, it's a lot of Percy things that are on the horizon. So we may not have seen the last of him. We'll see.
I would love to next time maybe have a seance and raise the ghost of Percy Miracles to let the record show. That'd be amazing. Just throwing it out there, you know, I don't know. But yeah, so what else can you tell us about this record? I mean, you were starting to talk about it's the first record that you guys own the rights to 100%.
Yeah, man, we you know, first album in 9-10 years, but we just decided from outright that, you know, this was a record we wanted to own, and we took care of everything ourselves, the sample clearances, the, you know, the A&R and picking the artwork, all the direction.
Lawyer fees.
All of that. Lawyer fees.
Yeah, lawyer fees, all the fees.
Sample clearance fees, all the damn fees. Hell yeah.
Yeah, because when you clear a sample, you not only got to pay for that, you got to pay for the fee for the person clearing the sample.
Yeah,
so
right.
So all of that, man, we took everything ourselves, man, and just, you know, it was a lot of hard work, but it's so rewarding. But not only the product, but just the response from the people.
Yeah.
Because, you know, you hear people talking about, oh, we want you to come back, or we want a, you know, new album, but you never really truly know how a person gonna respond to where you are.
It's time to pull some money out of their pocket.
Yeah, that's when it get real. Right. So just the response from this record from people was awesome. And then when we were able to go outside and tour, the thing for me that was awesome to see is how many people. We were always asking our concert, like, "Who is this your first time seeing Little Brother?" And just the amount of people each concert, well, that was their first time ever seeing us live was just amazing. That after all these years, you still have first timers. And it wasn't just a whole bunch of people that, oh, we've been here before. And, you know, just, nah, it was first timers.
A lot of new blood, yeah.
So it was real dope to see.
Nice.
What can we expect next? What's on the horizon?
Right now, just being in the damn house is on the horizon.
Nothing.
Yeah. I mean, you know, we're still definitely like creating. We're working on finishing up our documentary, like the full length like documentary. Again, we wanted to really tell our story and just kind of break everything down in a way for everyone had asked the question, like, well, man, what happened? What, you know, what went wrong? Whatever, you know, our documentary is, it'll be out and that answers everything. And, you know, so, you know, just really, I think that's the main thing for right now. And once life resumes in whatever way it's going to resume, we'll kind of pick it up from there because there was a lot of cities that, you know, me and Pooh didn't get a chance to hit. when, you know, when Corona happened. So, you know, right now, man, I think, you know, both of us just feel just thankful that we were able to finish this shit and get it out at the end of last year. Because I could not imagine, like, I think like, had we been in the middle of a Little Brother album and Corona hit, I think we both.
That would have just killed.
That may have been the one that broke the back. It's like, you know what? Maybe we were just doomed to just not do this. Fuck it. But, yeah, that would have killed it.
We would have had Peter Rosenberg, so.
Damn sure wouldn't have Peter Rosenberg. but nah, man. So, yeah, right now, I think we're just kind of just focusing on, you know, we just put out a video for Right On Time.
Yep.
And we also got a video for Everything, the song that's playing now, directed by my man Holland Gallagher, my man Dan Mercer. 7 Foot Giant, they did the one for Right On Time featuring Darren Brockington. And, you know, the vinyl's coming. You know, we're just, you know, I think right now everyone just kind of figuring this shit out as we go along, man. Yeah, you know, we don't know what it's going to be. We're just, you know, making the most of what we got.
Yeah. All right. Perfect. All right. There it is. Little Brother, May the Lord Watch. All right. This is Let the Record Show. I am Mike Pizzo.
I'm Warren Peace.
And special thanks to our guests, Little Brother.
Glad we finally do this, man.
Yeah. Hey, thank you so much for doing this, staying in your house, and you know, this is new for us, and you know, I think we nailed it.
It's new for us too, man.
Yeah, definitely. That's a lot of fun.
Everyone knows how to use Zoom now.
Perfect. Yo,
everybody.
Yo, like really, man. Yeah. I was reading an article on Zoom about the founder of Zoom, and he was just talking about like how now he gets an average of like 3 hours of sleep a night. He just, this was something that he just made. It's just, you know, little, you know, conference call software. Yeah. But one day you just woke up and the world needed it to be something else.
Yeah.
Like this thing that you created just to go to fucking conferences. There are now people attending funerals on Zoom.
Yeah.
Yeah. It's crazy.
Like just how fucking insane that is. Yeah. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
Like, so.
Yeah. Well, at least he can wipe his tears with his millions.
You're like, Yeah, his $1,200 check, that's toilet paper to him.
Right. Yeah.
Right. All right. Thank you, guys. We are out of here.
Thank God.
Peace.
Another one. Just fill me in. If I go too far, nigga, reel me in. Just making it real again. Tell me how to get back to the field again. Get back to the field, relax and chill. I got a license to ill again. Back to the field again. Get back to the field again.